Luke chapter 19, verses 11 through 27. If you have a child that's 5 or younger that might need a break, we have a couple volunteers that will be with the kids during the sermon. Again, we love having kids in worship. They learn a lot through hearing the Lord's Prayer, the Apostles' Creed, by watching parents and adults be reverent in worship. They learn a lot, so we love having kids in worship, but we know sometimes they need a break, and so we're thankful that we have folks that can help with that during the sermon. So everyone else, turn to Luke chapter 19, verses 11 through 27. Luke 19, 11 through 27. Again, as I mentioned earlier, this is the end of Christ's journey to Jerusalem. He's been traveling to Jerusalem since the end of chapter 9, Luke chapter 9. And this is the third event in Jericho as he passes through Jericho on the way to Jerusalem. Remember, he had healed the blind beggar. He had had this interaction with Zacchaeus we talked about last week. And then this is the final parable before Christ enters Jerusalem. And he's teaching his disciples. He's teaching them a very important lesson to prepare them for what's going to happen. And so he's teaching his disciples here in Luke chapter 19, verses 11 through 27. As they heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable because he was near to Jerusalem and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. He said, therefore, a nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then return. Calling 10 of his servants, he gave them 10 minas and said to them, engage in business until I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. When he returned, having received the kingdom, he ordered these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know what they had gained by doing business. The first came before him saying, Lord, your mina has made 10 minas more. And he said to him, well done, good servant. Because you have been faithful in very little, you shall have authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Lord, your mina has made 5 minas. And he said to him, and you are to be over 5 cities. Then another came, saying, Lord, here is your mina, which I kept laid away in a handkerchief. For I was afraid of you, because you are a severe man. You take what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow. He said to him, I will condemn you with your own words, you wicked servant. You knew that I was a severe man, taking what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow. Why then did you not put my money in the bank? And at my coming, I might have collected it with interest. And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to the one who has the 10 minas. And they said to him, but Lord, he has 10 minas. I tell you that to everyone who has, more will be given. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. But as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this passage from this parable from Luke 19, which is a wake-up call for us this morning on a cold morning with some serious truths that we need to consider and think about. And we pray that your Holy Spirit would teach us this morning through your word. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Well, many Americans right now are thinking and perhaps are concerned about retirement. Many Americans are thinking about retirement, maybe concerned about retirement. That day in the future when in their mind they can maybe sit back and relax a little bit, not have to work. And so many Americans are thinking about, maybe concerned about, when can I retire? Will I have enough money? What will Social Security look like whenever that distant day in the future happens? A couple interesting statistics on that as people think about retirement and think about that day when they can kind of relax maybe a little bit. 46% of Americans think that they will retire and still have debt. 46% of Americans think that when they retire, they're probably still going to have some debt to pay for. And part of that might be because, I don't know if you knew this, last year, 2021, almost 1 in 5 Americans did not save $1. Almost 1 in 5 Americans didn't save a dollar last year. The Commerce Department says that personal savings are at a 4-year low. On top of that, 1 in 3 Americans can't cover a $500 expense right now. One in three. Can't cover a $500 expense. So a problem with the car, a problem at the house, whatever, is going to break the bank for them next month. The Labor Department says consumer inflation is at a four-decade high. And so many Americans are thinking about retirement, but also kind of worried about, am I going to have enough? What's Social Security going to look like? How long is it going to take to get to that point? Interestingly enough, I read this, and I'm like, this is interesting. 30% of millennials and Gen Zers want to retire before the age of 50. Some aspiring people there. So good luck if you can do that. Good luck for millennials and Gen Zers. 30% want to retire before 50. Work hard. So the question is, have you thought about retirement lately? Are you thinking about it? Are you concerned about it, worried about it? That day that's kind of down the road when, man, hopefully we can just maybe take a break a little bit. And you're thinking about retirement and thinking about that day down the road, and you think, okay, in the meantime, in the years ahead, before that day hits, I need to work, I think. That's important. I need to save money. I might need to limit my expenses, might need to live on a budget, do a better job of saving. And those are things that you think about. Okay, I need to be very diligent this year on doing those things so that when that day comes when I can retire, I'm prepared for it. As we look at this parable, the main point of this parable is similar to that, because what Christ is saying is there's a day coming in the future down the road that you need to prepare for. And that day is not retirement. The day he's saying you need to take steps now to prepare for is the day when I return as king. The day when I, as Revelation says, when I make all things new. That day is coming. It's going to be more important than your retirement day. And when that day comes, you need to do things now to prepare for that. And so that's the main theme of this parable, is what are you doing now to prepare for that day when Christ comes? And so as we look at the story, what Christ is teaching them and trying to teach them about what's going to happen, they're approaching Jerusalem and they're passing through Jericho. And as I mentioned, Christ has already healed this blind beggar. And then he's had this encounter with Zacchaeus we talked about last week. This little guy Zacchaeus has a big faith in Jesus Christ, and it changes his life. And he gives, if you remember, a substantial amount, not of his income, but of his possessions away. Faith leads to actions. We saw that last week. And now here's the third and final event in Jericho. It's a parable. And it's a parable about a wealthy man who trusts his servants while he's away. Stewardship. He trusts his servants while he's away. And this is a common theme in ancient Near Eastern Jewish literature. And it's a common theme in the Gospels. You see four of these types of stories of a man going away and entrusting money or property to people while he's away, servants. You see it in Luke 12, Mark 13, and Matthew 25, and then here. So it's a common theme. A man goes away and leaves people in charge of something, and he's going to return. So Jesus tells this story of a rich man who's going away to receive a title as king, and before he leaves, he brings his servants, and he's going to give them some money. Verse 13, he brings his servants there, and he says, engage in business until I come back. That word engage in business is pragmatamoi, pragmatic. Be pragmatic. That's where we get that word. Be pragmatic until I come back. Engage in business. Be productive. Put the money to work. Be pragmatic. And so he gives them this money, and the money you can see probably if you have a, even if you have a thin Bible, but definitely if you have one of those thick Bibles, there's a footnote that says a mina is, you know, several months' wages. So you see the amount there. And he gives them this money, and he says, I'm coming back, and then I'll hold you accountable. He says, I'm going to return. It's going to be at an unknown time. And when I return, it's going to be with the title as king. So that's the story. It's interesting. One little footnote here that you should know, because as a principle to understand Scripture, you need to, first of all, understand what the original audience heard, how they heard it, and then you can apply it. Too often in Western Christianity, we look at a text and just want to apply it and have self-help tips. That's not how you do it. You need to understand what the original audience heard, and then you can begin to apply it. Here's the footnote. The people listening to this sermon, or listening to this parable, when Christ told it, they had a person in mind when he told this parable, because the historical context is this. About 40 years before Christ was born, there was a guy named Herod the Great. You read about him in Luke 1 and 2, right? In the Christmas story. Herod the Great in 40 BC, so about roughly 40 years before Christ was born, had to travel to Rome to get his title as king and to receive that from Rome. And he traveled back and he was the king. And he was a rough dude, a violent dude. You read about that in Luke's gospel. You read about it in Josephus. Well, Herod died roughly 4 BC. And when he died, Herod the Great died, his kingdom was left to three sons. And he wasn't that creative with the names of his sons. His first son is Herod Antipas. Second son is Herod Philip, so he likes the Herod name. Those are the first two. And then the third son is a guy named Archelaus. Archelaus. We'll call him Archie. We'll call him Archie. That's a better name. Well, Archie is the local ruler here in Judea. He rules over Jericho. And in 4 BC, when his father Herod the Great had died, Archie had to go to Rome to meet with Caesar Augustus to get his title as king. And when he went to Rome in 4 BC to get his title as king, there was a delegation of Jews that followed him to Rome to protest to Caesar Augustus to say, we don't want this guy as our king because he doesn't like us and he's going to kill us. He's a terrible ruler. And that was evidenced by the next year. He did receive the position. He didn't get the title of king, but he got the position. Archie did. The next Passover in Jerusalem, 3,000 Jews were slaughtered. He did not like his own people. And so the reason I tell you that is because when Christ tells this parable, the people in Jericho are thinking of their ruler. They don't like him. That's what they're thinking about. And so there's a historical context here that the crowd is hearing. But when Christ tells this story of the nobleman, it's not representing Archie, Archelaus. He's saying, this is how I'm acting. I'm going to be going away for a while. The nobleman, the rich man in this story is Christ. That's how we interpret it. And so as we look at the story, here's the first point that we understand from this parable. Christ is making the simple but necessary point to his disciples that he's going to go away. He's going to be absent. And while he's absent, they're going to have to be accountable for their actions because he is going to return. Because if you think about it, Peter, James, and John and the disciples, to a large extent, are still thinking that when we get to Jerusalem, we're in charge here. Like, we're going to take over Jerusalem. There's going to be this political leadership. Jesus is our guy. We're probably going to be like, you know, governors. We're going to be senators. We're going to be in charge. Jesus is our king. We're going to have political power. It's always a temptation. And Christ is saying, that's really not what's going to happen. When I go as a king, it's going to be as a crucified king. And then I'm going to go away as the church is expanding and growing. He's telling them, I'm going away so that when it does happen, they are prepared for his absence. And he's saying, I am going to return. And when I return, it will be as a visible king. And so the application here is this, for you and I, reading this 2,000 years later, we're living in that interim period between Christ's first coming and his second coming. We're living in that period after Bethlehem and before his return that you read about in Corinthians 15 and in Thessalonians and in much of the book of Revelation, which has seven parallel passages about Christ's return. We're living in that already not yet. He's already come once, but he's not yet fully consummated the kingdom and brought about his visible kingdom as a visible king. And so the point for us is while we wait in that interim, like the rich man here in the story who's gone away, you and I as followers of Christ are called to wait. To be patient, no matter what happens in the world, to be patient, to be faithful, no matter what happens in the news, to pray. And the prayer needs to be, Lord, we're praying for your return. We're praying that until you return, you would lead us. We're praying that until you return, you would guide us, that you would protect us. Lord, we're praying that until you return, you would use us to share the gospel, to be missionaries to the low country, to live for the gospel, to live for your glory, not for ourselves. And for us today, even when it seems like, man, you look at the headlines, it seems like there's a lot of problems, there's a lot of uncertainty in the world. As a Christian, you can read that and say, we should expect that. And we know that history is not on this uncertain path that might lead to World War III and it's going to be China, Russia, we know where history is leading. It's leading to Christ returning. And he will make everything right. He will make all things new. That's where history is going. And until that happens, no matter what happens in the news or in current events, we can trust that he will return and we are called to be faithful. We are called to pray and to wait until he returns. That's what we're called to do. If we look back at our text here, back at the parable, when the nobleman does return, he returns as a king, he brings his servants together and he's going to say, I need an account of what you did. I was gone for a while. I gave you some cash. What did you do? And so he brings a servant. Servant one comes, and he's made 10 minas more. He's had a very good ROI. He's done well. The second servant comes. He's made 5 minas more. He's done pretty well. He's been a good steward. And then another servant comes, and he's done nothing. He has done absolutely nothing. It says he hid it in a handkerchief. You might translate that he might have hid it in a scarf. So if you're traveling around that area, you'd have a scarf to cover your face from the sun so you didn't have sunburn. It looks like he probably just hid it in his scarf. The guy's pretty lazy. Because even under the Talmud, Jewish law, the bare minimum of security was at least buried in the ground so people can't find it. If you had a coin, you need to save it. At least buried in the ground. This guy just throws it in the scarf and he goes about his regular business. And so the rich man holds him accountable. And look at this man's response, the servant's response. He essentially blames the rich man. He blames the boss for his laziness, for his attitude. He says, look at the text. He says, because I know how severe you are. In Greek, that word severe is austeros, where we get austere. Austerity measures. I know how austere you are, how severe you are. In other words, what he's saying is, because I know you're such a mean guy, you're so severe, you're not really just, you're not a good boss, because you're so corrupt. It's really your fault I did nothing with it. That's what he's doing. It's projection, first of all. But it's also, he's blaming his boss for him not doing anything. It's very similar if you read Genesis 4, the first homicide in the Bible. Cain kills his brother. And what happens? The Lord says, where's your brother? And Cain says, I'm not my brother's keeper, which implies, aren't you taking care of your people, God? Aren't you taking care of Abel? He's blaming God. That's the attitude here. The servant did nothing with the money and then blamed his boss for saying, but you're kind of a bad guy, so I was scared, so I'm the victim. Victim mentality. Notice the response from the nobleman, the rich guy here. He says, but you didn't even put it in a bank. And the word there is you didn't even put it on a bench or on a table. You might have that in a footnote. And in our English word, bank comes from bench. And a bank means put the money on a bench, the bench or table of a moneylender. So you'd put the money on a bench or a table. The moneylender would take it and invest it, use it, loan it out, and make money off of it. And that's what you would do. That's where we get our word bank, from bench. And so he says, the rich man says, you didn't even try. You were lazy. You were apathetic. You did absolutely nothing with this. He's disgusted by his actions. And then look at the end of this parable, the end of the story. And consider this. Does the end of this story surprise you? Because in many ways, the American Jesus, the Western Jesus, is a pretty tolerant guy who puts up with all of our nonsense and all of the things that we should not be doing. And Jesus just kind of like, oh, I'll let it slide. The Western Jesus would say, oh, so you messed up, you were lazy, you're apathetic, no big deal, just try again next time, it's okay, it'll all work out. That's not what Christ teaches. He's more direct. He says, the gift will be taken from you, and my enemies will be punished. Look at verse 27. As for those enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. That's a blunt message on a cold morning. Because Jesus is that person in the story. He's saying, the enemies will have to be held accountable. Bring them here and slaughter them. And the image, I think, this is how I read it, in the back of my mind as I read this, is the story of a previous king, the first king of Israel, Saul, who did not do his job in 1 Samuel 15. He was to punish King Agag, and he didn't. He took some stuff and said, oh, look at this. And the end of 1 Samuel 15, you have Mr. Samuel, the clergy, a guy who's preaching, prophesying, knows the law, the Torah. What does he do? He grabs a hatchet and he says, bring Agag here. And the end of 1 Samuel 15, it says he hacked Agag to pieces before the Lord. Really violent imagery. That's the image here. Christ says, these people will be punished for their rejection. And so Christ is waking up his listeners. He's saying, take this seriously. Apathy isn't an option while I'm away. You have to act. And so here's the second point here this morning. It's a very obvious point about being active while the king is away. The point is this. God has given each of you gifts to use for his glory, for his kingdom, and for his church. God has given every follower of his gifts to use for his glory, for his kingdom, and for his church. And we are called to use them. What are those gifts? It could be any number of things. I made a list of a few. You could have a gift of serving others and helping others. You could have a gift of teaching others and be involved in teaching. You might have a gift of discipling others in the faith. Maybe you're gifted in sharing the gospel and you have really good skills with people and finding ways and conversations to share the gospel. Maybe your gift is time. You have more time on your hands than other folks and you can use that for God's glory. Maybe your gift is God has given you an abundance of money and you can use that for God's glory. Or it could be A, C, B. It could be all the above. It could be two out of three. It could be any number or combination of those gifts that God gives you that you are called to use for His glory, for His kingdom, and for His church. And this is a local expression of His church. God calls you to use those gifts for Him. And so think about it. What are those gifts that God has given me? Think about that for a moment. Then the second question, which might be a little scary, is this. Okay, those are the gifts, the things that God has given me. Am I using those for God's glory? Am I using those for His kingdom? Am I using those in the local church? Are you using what God has given you to build up His church? If you're not, is it because maybe you're just too busy? That's kind of the plague of our age, we're just too busy. Is it maybe you're just too afraid? What if I fail? What if my gifts are not that great? What if I'm not that gifted? Well, then we'll find another gift. If you try one and fail, that means it's not your gift. That means you have a gift somewhere else. Just trial and error. Are you using your gifts? And if you think, well, you know, everything's kind of taken care of in the church. I don't need to help with things. No, there's always more to help with. If you have questions about how you can help, you can always ask Devin. He will give you some things. You can ask Gary. You can ask Emily. We always need help in different ways. Ask. If you're like, hey, how can I help? How can I help build up the church? Another way to say that truth of using your gifts is this. As a Christian, as a follower of Christ, you can't stand still spiritually. As a Christian, you cannot be static and like a cement statue and just not moving spiritually as a Christian. You can't put discipleship on hold or put your gifts on hold. And the image I thought of when I thought about it this week, working on the sermon, is for a Christian not to use their gifts and just to be kind of static like a statue. It's like a runner getting on a treadmill, and the treadmill starts up and you just stand. What's going to happen? You're going off the end of the treadmill. You will fall. You will get injured. You will not be productive. That's the imagery of a Christian who's not actively using their gifts. You're either moving forward in the gospel, using the gifts that God gives you for His glory, for His kingdom, for His church, or you're not. You're ultimately regressing. And that's a spiritual loss. Look at verse 24. Christ says, take the mina from him and give it to the one who has the 10. To everyone who has, more will be given, but from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Sometimes Christ gives you like some tough words. These are some tough words. But that's a good thing because Christ doesn't just give you kind of like nice little soft little chewable Christianity. He gives you truth and you have to digest it. You have to think about it. You have to, under the ministry of the Holy Spirit, think about it and sometimes be convicted. Christ says, if you won't use what God has given you, it will be taken from you. And if you have a pen and feel comfortable writing in your Bible and have a hard copy, you should write Luke chapter 16, verse 10. One who is faithful in very little is faithful in much. Christ has already made this point. If you're faithful in a little, I've given you a little bit, and you use it, you'll be faithful in much. Luke chapter 16, verse 10. So God calls you to be, while the king is away, to be active in your growth in the gospel, to be active in sanctification, using maybe it's time that God's giving you, maybe it's gifts or abilities, evangelism, discipleship, maybe it's money, maybe whatever it might be, service, or maybe it's teaching. God calls you to use that for His glory, for His kingdom, for His church. And we cannot be apathetic about that. We can't be too busy. We must be using it. Philippians 2, verse 12, Paul says, continue to work out your salvation. It doesn't say work out to earn it. He says, work it out, demonstrate it. Use what God has given you. Philippians 2, 12. Work out your salvation. Demonstrate your faith through what you do. It's James chapter 2. A faith that isn't doing anything is a dead faith. It's really not a faith. That's what James is saying. A faith needs to be alive. We can't do nothing and expect results and expect that God will use us. Recently, I read an American folk story. It's an old story from many years ago about this rough and tough man who worked on the rivers. And this is a pretty tough dude. We probably feel uncomfortable if he came in the back of the Darby building. He probably had a lot of disgusting facial hair. He probably smelled worse than any of us in this room. Probably just hadn't changed clothes or had a clean pair of clothes. Tough, rugged dude. And he worked on the rivers. He worked primarily on the Mississippi River. And he would haul cargo, work on his boat, hauling cargo from St. Louis all the way down to New Orleans. And as the story goes, every time he'd come into port, he would go to this little French-owned gambling house, a little gambling house, and he'd play roulette. And that was his thing. And he would, every time he'd go in there when he was in port, he'd put a quarter down on red, and that was his thing. He never put more money or less money. It was always just put a quarter down on red. That's what he would do. So one evening, he comes into port, and he gets all the stuff done for work. He goes to this little gambling house, and he sits down at the bar, and he gives the owner of the place a quarter and says, bet on red, and then he leans forward and puts his head on his hand. And the guy, the owner of the place, spins it, and he wins, and his money is doubled. And so the owner looks at him, and the guy's just kind of sitting there like this. He's not taking his money back, so the guy spins it again. He's got 50 cents, so double or nothing. So he spins it again, and he wins again. Now he's up to a dollar, and the French owner looks at the rough and tough guy who's just sitting there like this, and he hasn't removed his dollar, so he spins again, and he wins again, and he keeps winning and doubling his money, and the French owner of this place begins to sweat, get a little bit nervous because the money is getting serious, and after several minutes of winning and winning and winning and doubling his money, the captain's 25 cents becomes over $8,000. Bet on red, just bets on red. And so finally, this French owner of this place is upset because he realizes he's going out of business. He can't afford this. This is many years ago. And so he angrily pushes the money across the table to this rough and tough river captain and orders him to leave at once. And the river captain just sits there with his head on his hand. The captain doesn't move. And so finally, the French owner walks around and pushes this captain because he's lost so much money. And the captain falls off his chair like a rock. He was dead. After he put the quarter down, he died. And so every time the French owner looked at him to say what he wanted to do, he wasn't moving because nothing was happening. He had expired. And he kept doubling his money. His biggest success ever was when he was dead. His biggest success ever happened because he did nothing. And here's why I share that. It's a remarkable story because it's unexpected. How does doing nothing pay off? How does doing nothing yield those results? And that's really the theme here. And really, for us, the challenge or temptation is we can't expect spiritually to do nothing and think there's going to be results. Right? We can't do nothing, not use our gifts, and just be apathetic, be lazy, whatever, be too busy, whatever it might be, and expect that there's going to be spiritual fruit, that there's going to be an expansion of God's church, His kingdom, of the gospel message. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. We can't live life like this gambler who just sits there and then died and think things are just going to work out and be fine and we don't have to do anything. That's not how it works. And so this morning, as we finish up, two thoughts. This morning, if you're listening to this message and you're not a Christian, then here's the main point. Before you can put your gifts to service for the Lord, you have to not use gifts, but accept the giver. You have to accept Christ first. That's the first thing. You can't use things to honor God if you don't even know Him, if you're not living for Him. You have to receive the gift, His life, His death, His resurrection, and put your faith in Him first of all. If you're here this morning and you don't know Him. The second point is this. If you are a Christian, you're like, well, Ben, I'm following Christ. I'm a disciple of Christ. The point here is you can't live the Christian life to God's glory like this rough and tough gambler at the roulette table by not doing anything and expecting to have all of this success spiritually. It's not going to happen. That's what Christ is saying. Faith without an application of faith, using faith, is dead, James chapter 2. And so this morning, consider what gifts God has given you in your own life. And then consider, how can I use those? Whatever those gifts might be, time or money or gifts of teaching or of service, whatever they might be, how can I use those to build up the kingdom of God, God's church? And we do it, again, I try to say this pretty much every week, we do it not to pay God back, not to earn something, not out of guilt, but out of gratitude for His grace because we know that Christ has already gone to the cross for us. He rose again on the first day of the week. That's why we meet on the first day of the week. And we know, as the parable tells us and as the Word of God tells us, that king who suffered and died, he is returning. That is a promise. That is not just, let's hope it happens. It is a promise that he will return. And we're to be active until he comes out of gratitude for his grace. And so this morning, think about that. Consider that truth as we come to the sacrament, as we come and celebrate this mystery of God's grace, that he would save us and that he gives us signs and symbols, seals of his grace to us with this bread and with this juice. Think about that this morning as we receive the Lord's Supper. Let's pray.